shift actually from to a completely different topic. We learnt about the phylayer, we learnt about the MAC layer, network backbone, telecommunication security, the antenna aspects. So, from all angle we try to equip ourselves for the short range communication system designs, I should say. There is a very important topic related to any short range communication network design, which is related to the term called so called quote unquote coexistence. As the term suggests, coexistence means the how the multiple radio access technologies operating in the same frequency band can be utilized for simultaneous operation. Okay. We understand the fundamental problem that tomorrow the same handheld device is going to be equipped with multiple radio access technology. There is no doubt about it. You will be utilizing the cellular communication as well as the multiple short range communications by like Bluetooth millimeter wave technology enabled short range, for example, 60 gigahertz, WLAN, they all will be there in your handset. And some of those technologies, they are operating in the same center frequency, same band of transmission. If it is an ISM band, then it is a 2.4 gigahertz, and if they are the other stuff, so they are having the collaboration with some other technologies almost. So, let us have a very broad view first of all, the who can coexist with which technology. And in order to make them coexist, what are the solutions from the standard perspective people have thought, and what are the other solutions from the receiver design angle itself people have thought. But remember, without understanding coexistence, the system design for future is not possible, simply not possible. Okay. And today IEEE has already put the mandatory option that you have to coexist. If you are suggesting some new technology, you have to coexist with the other existing technology in that frequency band. So, it is a very, very important pillar of the system design as well as the network design. No, it may be a heterogeneous, in one sense it is a heterogeneous network you are talking about. Using different technology, if it is, then it is definitely. See, actually there is basic difference between your multi-user environment and the same network, same technology with multiple networks. Suppose multiple UWB networks, whether they can stay there or not, this is one kind of coexistence. Another coexistence is whether Bluetooth will coexist, can withstand with Wi-Fi or not. Okay. So, across the technologies and within the technologies, both way you can actually think of it. Usually whenever we devise a typical technology, we think a solution for the multiple same kind of the network, how we will coexist. For example, in the cellular communication, we go for the frequency reuse. Okay. We have a definite plan of the frequency, so that in the cellular communication zone, the interference can be minimized. We never think of whether I am giving some interference to Bluetooth. How Bluetooth will sustain, as if there is a headache of Bluetooth itself. That was the mode when wireless communication was progressing, nobody thought of others. Today we are in a situation that when this convergence is expected to happen because of hyper connectivity expected from all of us, then they need to cooperate now suddenly. So, without cooperation you cannot sustain in this competitive world. So, that cooperation is bringing the term called coexistence issue. You address the coexistence issue. Then the outline will be this way. We will start with the short introduction and try to understand the problems of the coexistence in terms of the different technology over the different same different frequency bands of operation, and in terms of their power transmission, not only the frequency, it is the power on the top of that, they are transmitting and interfering with each other. And then finally, coming to some important case studies. It is very important to understand the coexistence issue by taking some examples. So, I have put here three examples to give you an idea how coexistence is already addressed in the existing technologies. But these three are a very exemplary stuff. You can do a device of your own. So coexistence is an area where a lot of patents you will find there are rather than the papers. It's a intellectual property wise, it is very, very rich area where easily actually with your own solution you can file a patent. And that then the conclusion will be there. Going by the IEEE definition, coexistence means it can be of two ways. One is a cooperative way, another is a non-cooperative way. They call it collaborative or non-collaborative. Collaborative means, yes, Wi-Fi AP can talk to Bluetooth AP, and jointly they are means both of them are understanding their requirements, and on the fly both of them mutually are supporting the users of the both technology. This is the meaning of collaborative, where two different technology at least can talk in the MAC layer or above. Another point is non-collaborative, means suppose one technology, the central part of one technology, he cannot talk to other technology, he needs to be in a passive mode somehow to find out the solution. In presence of the others, he needs to find out some solution of transmitting the data for his own technology. It's an intelligent way. Got it? So, you need not to know, you need not to communicate to other technology what he is doing, but understanding is that when somebody is transmitting, you will not disturb him if you are a good user, and you will find some other way of your data to be transmitted in the same frequencies. This is non-collaborative, because these two APs are not, they are not talking to each other. So, maybe they are, it is not an optimal solution that could be found for both the technologies. But somehow both of them can sustain without disturbing each other. I am not disturbing you because I am not able to talk to you. There is no protocol developed by means of which I can tell Wi-Fi AP that, hey, this is the requirements of mine. Now I wish to transmit, you help me out. Can we come to a common collaborative solution such that both of our users can transmit over the air? Because air is because the transmission channel is common for both of us. Okay? So, both the way coexistence solutions are there in the practice, and both the way this coexistence solution also can be thought of for the future. This is the overall picture, the way we can differentiate the different kind of the users over the several meters. We start with the PAN, okay, personal area networks, which is having a several meters to the tens of the meters. And basic IEEE group who is dealing with it is IEEE 802.15. Interestingly, we have talked about the standardization document. I have told you that there are separate documents for the FIMAC solution from the standards and the network and above. Interestingly, there are separate standard group working under the broad umbrella of the same technology. You will see that standard documents are also available for the coexistence solutions for that technology these days. Under dot 15, you will find that the standardization issues and documents, the groups, dedicated group working for the coexistence, and their documents, their technical reports are also available on the IEEE site. So, going to the LAN, the local area networks, mainly dominated by WLAN and very popular technology it is. It is governed by dot 11, we understand. If you go a little bit higher range in terms of the coverage range, covering range, it is the MAN, which is a metropolitan area network, and where we deal with the fixed wireless as well as the nomadic wireless access. And dot 16 is the group of the IEEE who is dealing with this metropolitan area networks. If I go towards the several tens of the kilometers, then it is a wide area network we call it. And IEEE 802.20, they are the group who is looking after all this. So, why I have given you this document once again, the references, where to go and search for if I am developing actually some coexistence between suppose WLAN to Bluetooth, then ZigBee to WLAN or ZigBee to some other technologies which is the fixed wireless or your nomadic wireless access and all. So where to go, how to search, which document I should search, which technology I should follow, whether it is very hard to develop these two technology to coexist or not, to understand all that. So this is a very basic guideline through which you can migrate. Very important understanding over the frequency range. Basically, three frequency zones are very, very popular for the short range communication. All are the ISM bands. One is your 868 megahertz, most popular is the 2.4 gigahertz zone, and see the density of the different technologies who are residing on 2.4 gigahertz. Starting for your from your Zigbee, all the 15.4 devices and technologies, 15.6 supporting technologies for your Zigbee, Bluetooth, WiMAX, and whole WLAN series is here. In 5 gigahertz, WLAN and your ultra wideband also is establishing there. Problem is not only the frequency, problem is their application was different. So, the power limit, the data rate requirement was different. Hence, the power limit, the transmission power limit, when FCC released the order, that was also different. WLAN was the prime user of 2.4 gigahertz, it was the priority user. So, FCC told that they can transmit with 20 dBm, 100 milliwatt power. Compared to that, nobody else have been given that much high power. Especially Zigbee and your Bluetooth, Bluetooth is having a more or less close to this power, but Zigbee never actually crossed that very minimal power of say hardly 1 milliwatt to 2 milliwatt kind of, not beyond that. So, another problem started when we saw the thing in a 5 gigahertz. To coexist with Wi-Fi, ultra wideband had to think lot of the technologies when the standardization was getting developed by itself, fine. The most popular zone for considering the effect and devising the different coexistence technology is till today is 2.4 gigahertz itself. Okay, because Wi-Fi and Bluetooth both are actually very, very popular technology, the most popular technologies which are already implemented in the handheld devices. And depending upon the growth of their next and next and next data rate that they are coming up with, and their next and next of their support, both the technologies are coming up with, and service support they are coming up with, coexistence issues are becoming also very much critical. It is not like that the first generation coexistence solution for Wi-Fi and Bluetooth is still applicable for both these technologies. When Wi-Fi is suddenly giving you a data rate support with a MIMO technology and all, and Bluetooth is also telling that I can also give you a very high data rate support. Okay. So, though the area was coverage area wise they are different, but the because of the overlapping of the transmission frequency bandwidth they are utilizing and closeness of the power transmission, these two technologies are always fighting for the coexistence issues. If we see here, the technologies we have kept horizontally as well as vertically and tried to utilize who you are in terms of the your interference, who are giving the very severe interference to each other. For that you will see that when Bluetooth is existing with Wi-Fi, it is a red zone. The amount of the interference that is coming, it is very severe, more than 55 dB your interference amount you can expect if the both of them are there. So, like that the GPS with GSM 800, GPS with your CDMA 1800, though it is not a part of the short range, but even in the outdoor you are having the problems with this GPS GSM. The green next is severe zone as the yellow zone, where UWB and Wi-Fi are under this consideration, where your amount of interference is expected to be in the zone of in the range of 40 to 55 dB. You should be cautious about the interference for this this area, and almost you can utilize both the technologies without any problem if you are seeing wherever you are seeing the green color green. Okay. But the key part is Wi-Fi Bluetooth, yes it is dangerous. Okay. Without coexistence solution we should not proceed. Yeah. Means Wi-Fi on Bluetooth, and offers is Bluetooth on Wi-Fi. Okay, it is about the power limit. Who is giving transmitting with higher power, and who is giving more to whom? Yes. White means actually of no consideration. CDMA 1800 and GSM 800, the technology itself are so different that the question of the interference is not coming into picture like that. Okay. Next, as we are talking everything about the Wi-Fi, so let us see on Wi-Fi how the interference can come from the non-Wi-Fi devices. Which kind of the device is giving more prone to give the severe interference on the Wi-Fi? X-axis is giving the severity level of interference on Wi-Fi. And this x-axis wise, we are keeping the technologies which are very popular in terms of the use of the Bluetooth is very high compared to the use of the Zigbee. So, if you try to see the density of a Zigbee network and the density of a Bluetooth network, you will find more Bluetooth users in the network than the Zigbee network. So, the accumulated interference on the Wi-Fi will be higher from the Bluetooth than from the Zigbee networks. That is another study. One is the technology, another is the usage of that technology in practice. So, in whenever you are deploying a network, you are really bothered about only not the technology. How many users are going to use that technology? What is the density of acceptance of that technology? So, the integrated amount of the interference, that is I am expected to get, whether multiple users are using, when multiple users are using the Bluetooth, Bluetooth density, load density is extremely at the peak. So, what is that peak interference that is coming on the Wi-Fi network is also the point of the interest. So, going by the same point, your analog security cameras, their severity is very high, but the digital security cameras are more popular in practice. Okay. Cordless phones, we are becoming very popular zone, so its severity level is medium. We all use a microwave oven. So, its acceptance in the society is high, and its severity level over the Wi-Fi is also high. Jammers, they can give the highest interference because they usually jam with high power, but over Wi-Fi, the jammers, presence of the jammers are not that much. It is not that they are not existing, they are there, but their presence is not that much. So, now why this picture is important now for system design? If whether I am designing a Bluetooth transceiver or I am designing something for a microwave oven and all, whether I am designing a Wi-Fi, and then if I am designing a Wi-Fi, this picture I should always keep in my mind, because whoever can give me some interference on my network, whoever is having the maximum usage market, where is the severity level from that to my WLAN network, that all needs to be considered. So, from here we will proceed. The case one is very funny. Whatever we talked till now, it is not talking about that. This is the latest usage that came into picture. LTE does not use 5 gigahertz band, right? LTE usually uses the 900 megahertz band, 1800-900 megahertz band. But tomorrow there is a proposal in the latest revision of LTE that let LTE get use the unlicensed band also suddenly. So, that will be the fast migration before jumping to the 5 gigahertz outdoor. Okay. So, if that is the fast initial step, so next immediate unlicensed band is where 2.4 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz. So, let LTE get migrated or updated in terms of the little bit next higher frequencies, and those higher frequencies are the unlicensed band. So, immediately before devising the circuit itself or coming up the proposal itself, problem and question of coexistence immediately came up. How LTE will coexist, the few channels that you are allocating there, how actually will be the coexistence mechanism with Wi-Fi? Fine. If we see the how that way the traffic is increasing, this is a clear picture the traffic is getting doubled over every year of the mobile communication or cellular communication network. This doubling structure per year basis, especially in USA and all. So, this doubling structure has ignited the increment of the frequency bands for LTE. Solution that LTE could find, that let us proceed the unlicensed band like 2.4, 5.1, 5.3, 5.4. So, this is a whole zone of something around 5 gigahertz, 5 to 6 gigahertz, and some multiple channels they could identify, and with the bandwidth that really matches with the existing LTE bandwidths, channel bandwidths, and it will be aligned with the receiver design also. You need not to change the signal bandwidth in that way. So, let us migrate towards that. Problem is what? Wi-Fi is standing there, both in the 2.4 and the 5 gig. What will be the use of that new unlicensed band? They said that we will be giving the channel called the primary channel and the secondary channel. Primary channel will be from the LTE original bands 900, 1800. Secondary channels, they will be from the unlicensed bands. So, this secondary channel, so primary carrier that uses the licensed spectrum, there we will utilize the control signal, mobility, user data, all those data will be going on. Okay. They will be working over the either frequency division duplexing mode or time division duplexing mode. So, the channel operation will be there as usual as per the standard LTE document. But when the secondary channel will come into picture, they will be using the unlicensed spectrum, and basically the best effort user data will be utilized there. I can utilize those secondary channel to enhance the quality of the service of my network. So, I will repeat, maybe one option is I will repeat the data on the secondary channel, and in the receiver I will have a carrier aggregation. I will receive the signal from both the subcarrier, both the carriers 2.4 as well as my traditional 900, and I will actually combine those data to enhance the quality of the data received before I feed the data to the decoder. That is the application that they thought of. Okay. So, where actually I should be very care of? I should be very much care of the interference on the secondary user channels, secondary channels, okay, not the primary one. Solution number one, they told that LTE told the, actually do not think that the solution is given by the standard. Okay. Somebody like us came up with the solution and this paper is out now. So, this is one of the first few, very few papers, okay, who are addressing this burning issue of LTE coexisting with Wi-Fi. So, what they came up with the solution is, let us go by the mode of listen before talk. Listen before talk means what you are doing? You are listening to the channel, whether some communication is going on. So, you will switch your receiver to the new 2.4 gigahertz or 5 gigahertz channels, and you will try to measure the power there and try to guess whether some Wi-Fi communication is going on or no, it is nothing is going on. What basically you are doing, you know? How can I term this activity? Spectrum sensing. Is it anything else than the cognitive radio fundamentals? It is not. So, in that sense, so power sensing, channel sensing, this is already the concept of the cognitive radio already is in the cellular communication domain. Okay. In terms of the coexistence, in order to support coexistence. Okay. In future, you may see that now LTE is also hopping after sensing where the power is minimized, whether in the secondary channel or in the primary channel. Definitely, I would like to toggle where to send my control signal and the data signal for the time being, right. So, then that is the second stage of the cognition, that is the cognition cycle. So, cognitive radio, the concept earlier was that is a separate branch of the research itself, where will be the utilization and all, nobody knew. But with the context of today and tomorrow's actually high density multi radio access technology and coexistence issues, cognitive radio is already in. Fine. So, what they did? See, in the LTE frame, if you see, there is a frame period, which is a fixed frame period. Within that period, some portion of the time LTE, actually there is a chance that there will be a occupancy time of the channel, I mean actual data transmission is going on, and for the rest of the time there is a ideal period kept. Okay. What LTE did a frame based equipment where they told, so before that fixed frame period, I will dedicate a portion which will be talking about the clear channel access indication and detection, detection and indication. So, within that ideal period some portion will be dedicated for doing this power sensing, I mean the spectrum sensing, and after I sense the channel then I will go ahead with the transmission, as simple as that. So, they are reducing the ideal period or dividing the portion of the ideal period, they are dedicated, they are dedicating for the spectrum sensing. So, this is a call, this is called frame based equipment. Alternatively, they told that let us having a extended carrier channel sense, and what is that? Do not wait for a single, do not rely on a single time carrier sense. Please repeat it for n number of the periods to become confirmed that yes, the channel is free now for a pretty good period of the time, and so I can start my transmission. That is the scenario, then this is a load based equipment. Okay. See, idea is simple because this is the first solution came up. So, from this time onwards, based on the different frame structure of the Wi-Fi as well as the LTE, several kind of the solutions can come up from our side. Going ahead from here, Bluetooth and Wi-Fi coexistence is very bitten topic actually. Were given by the, if you search in the Google patent, means dozens of patents you will see for the Wi-Fi Bluetooth coexistence. If you search for the papers starting from the very good journal papers to the conference papers, you will see huge papers are there for the coexistence of Wi-Fi Bluetooth. Okay. So, I am giving a very simple example what is very popular and simplistic way of doing the coexistence between these two. Situation is when both WLAN as well as Bluetooth users are on and none of them are ready to actually means give the preference to other. Okay. Because none of the technologies came up with the solution that they will talk to each other and they will do something. Later on when they realize both of them are very powerful in the market, then they came up with some common protocol like time division duplexing. Okay. What is that? So, sorry, time division multiplexing kind of. How it is that? This time division duplexing or multiplexing, whatever you say, if I am having the stream of the data, okay, some central controller should be there who is having a stream of the data both from the WLAN as well as the Bluetooth. So, I understand actually the from the signature of the packets that which is from the WLAN, which is from the Bluetooth. So, based on that I have prepared my queue, the data are in the buffer, and then the central part will do what? He will actually do the time division duplexing. One time one slot will be given by Bluetooth, one slot will be given by the WLAN. So, one WLAN packet will go immediately followed by a Bluetooth packet. So, like that he will pick up. Picking up the packets and the speed for picking up is actually really an extremely high data rate. So, none of the users will realize that actually that kind of the switching or migration is going on. And very important part that number of the times the Bluetooth user is getting the chance, that should be always equal the number of the time a WLAN user is getting the chance to access the channel. Okay. So, what we understood is actually the last solution that I will talk about. In general, what is the problem? Problem is, very fundamental problem is, if there exists a low power device and there exists a high power device, the severity of the problem is here. Both are sharing a same carrier frequency, same channel bandwidth, but one is transmitting at a very low power, compared to the other guy who is transmitting at a very high power. That is the most severe situation that you can think of in a field of coexistence. So, is there any common solution irrespective of the technology name and all which can address this issue? So, the problem statement is two different technology is there, two different users are there. One is a low power device, another is a high power device sharing the same frequency band and same bandwidth also. So, what will be the strategy to coexist between these two? Remember, the solution that I will talk about here is a non-collaborative one. Understanding that high power device is giving me interference and I am unable to talk to him. Tomorrow I will develop lot of sensor networks. I am always will be in a low power zone and I am not able to talk to a high power device like a Wi-Fi AP, but I need to coexist with him. So, how to actually go ahead about that? That is the problem statement. So, in general this is the situation. See, this is the Wi-Fi, all the blue lines are the Wi-Fi communication going on and these are the sensor nodes who are talking with each other over the sensor network. This is a handheld device which is enabled by Wi-Fi as well as the Bluetooth. Okay. So, this is a network within an area this communication is going on. Remember, all of them are using 2.4 gigahertz ISM band. Bandwidth of operation is almost same. Power level for all these networks are different. So, where the interference is going on? Fast interference is here. Wi-Fi interfering over the sensor networks heavily because Wi-Fi is transmitting at 20 dBm, sensor signal is 0 dBm. So, 100 times higher power somebody is interfering me. Another situation, Bluetooth also is interfering my sensor network. Bluetooth power is also really very high, 10 dBm and above compared to the sensor networks. Sensor networks are always bound to design the networks with the transmit power of 0 dBm, close to 0 dBm. You will never see the sensor networks coming up above 0 dBm. Okay. So, milliwatt power versus actually 1 milliwatt power versus your 100 milliwatt power, that is the race is about where you need to find the solution. So, access point, if you see, access point is already some common access point is there who is having the access of the lower power device as well as the high power device. Both are communicating and access point is having the idea that this kind of that complicated network is there under me. Okay. Suppose the situation is such that high power device, this access point will be giving you some chance or some kind of the solution for accessing the channel, but the low power device will also enable and help the AP to give him the chance to access the channel in the presence of the interference. He will never demand, simplest thing is when he is not using, I will use. That is a DDMA kind of, but apart from that, can you provide some suggestion when he is also is irrespective of the fact that the high power device is in the communication, I can also do some communication, low power device also can do some communication is the problem statement. Okay. We understood that you give him and then you give him complete interference free, but this is a completely different situation without disturbing or without knowing whether actually the high power device is transmitting, can I transmit or can I can't. Situation is starting from here, low power device, pi layer, the whole 83 megahertz, he will have small 1 megahertz channel. So, he has actually divided the available bandwidth with small 1 megahertz chunk. This 1 megahertz is the channels, there is a provision that you can be given one channel or multiple channel and you have the capacity, the receiver is having the capacity to do the aggregation over the multiple channels, that is the basic assumption. Another important thing is the pi layer of this low power device, what does he do is, he transmits the signal over the each and every channel by means of space spectrum communication. Second important part is, the for space spectrum you need a code. So, there is a series or bank of the codes who will actually separate out the channel versus channel for himself. Okay? Why has he done this? Because he understands that in the low power zone, he is there won't be a single user, there may be multiple users. So, even if I give the same channel to two different users, if the orthogonal codes are different, both of them can get back their signal. Okay? To make his own network highly flexible, he has come up with this kind of solution. So, how the process is starting? See, low power device is now in the situation to transmit something. He will first generate the association request message. In order to send the association request message, this is what? This is to tell AP, hello, I wish to start some transmission in the network. When he will try to do that, he needs to transmit it over one of those 83 channels. What he will do? He will do the sensing, he will do the channel sensing for himself. He has the capability. So, according to that measurements of the power over each and every channel, he will have a profile of the power he is measuring sitting at his end. So, based on that, whatever the channel he feels that the transmitted measured power is minimum, to in that typical channel he will transmit. AP is having the capacity of addressing all those or scanning over all those 83 channels. So, he is keeping on continuously sending the association request. The time when actually this is there for AP to see whether somebody is sending me the association request or not, when he will try to see that zone, that time period, he will see that somebody is asking me for association. If association is coming up, what access point will do? Access point knows very, very well. This receiver is not having an access, very well access of who the other Wi-Fi APs are sitting, who is doing what, where the channels are distributed for AP, for Wi-Fi. But this access point is having the knowledge where are the other APs sitting, I mean what are the other channel distributions for the surrounding APs, how many number of the such sensor networks are already on. So, the whole network interference profile is there in the AP, which he has developed based on the continuous scanning of the network that he is operating and controlling. So, based on that interference profile, and he understands that this typical low power device is having 83 different channel. I can tell him better when actually this uplink will come up, the data transmission will come up, in which typical channel he will have the base performance. I mean the interference profile is really very low. He will now segregate this 83 channels based on the best channels, medium channel and the poor channel based on the interference amount he is measuring over a certain time period. He will also tell, he also knows what is the data rate requirement, quality of service requirement that is coming as a part of the association request. If it is actually acceptable, then he determines some interference handling scheme. What is this handling scheme? I am coming later on. Handling scheme actually is nothing but telling him that you use this number of the, this is the channel and use these are the orthogonal codes, you choose this orthogonal codes. We will give you the maximum orthogonalization, so your minimal interference you will be able to get. To identify what should be the code choice for him and what should be the channel to be used for him for data communication, this is the interference handling scheme AP is suggesting the device, low power device. And here he is allocating those channels and also the codes, compute the admissible data rate, because he knows the interference profile. You may have asked for 1 Gbps data rate, but AP knows that maximum 500 Mbps will be the best at this situation given the interference profile. He will suggest the device, you start transmission with 500 Mbps. It will take some more time for your data transmission, but it will be error free. Okay? So, those suggestions, finalizing the data rate will be done by AP, and he will generate some association transmission message. That message is now getting transmitted. So, here this one I have already told, he will actually categorize the channels as good, medium and bad. based on the interference profile that he is having. So, from access point, low power device has got the transmit association response message. Remember what is coming in the response message? There are two set of the parameters in the response message. I will show the structure of the message later on. Second set of parameters from the association response message, the LPD will extract, and from there he will determine what is the signal processing scheme I should proceed with, what is the data generated based on the signal processing message that I should go ahead with, and after generating the data signal he will transmit it to the access point. He will display the data, because displaying is suppose required. He understands how he will display. He knows actually what the code he suggested the LPD to transmit with, and LPD has blindly followed those codes. So, using those code actually you can decorrelate and display the data sitting in the AP and process it. The question starts from here. The received data packet from the low power device now been displayed and decoded in the AP. He is checking whether the received data packet for the is it the fast data packet or no. If it is the fast data packet, then he will measure the signal to interference noise ratio. Okay. And if the measured signal to interference noise ratio is below the signal some threshold SNR, he understands what is the modulation, what is the coding scheme he has suggested to the LPD. But he could not do one thing. He, though he has measured the up, based on the uplink, he has done all those mapping. By that time, whether channel has changed when he has sent the data, by that time whether the channel has changed or not, that he does not know. So, after receiving the immediate the first packet, so what he will do, he will start measuring the SINR, and he has put some threshold. Suppose if it is a BPSK communication, I need minimal this much amount of the SINR. Based on the receiver sensitivity, he can really measure it. If the level is above 3 dB from the SINR level, then I am sure that I can detect the stuff very nicely, and it will be error free communication. He measures that whether it is correct according to his preliminary knowledge and preliminary suggestions. If it is not, then he suggests him to do something else. If it is yes, then he determines the interference handling scheme based on the interference on the available channels and reallocate the channels. If it is not, then you have to reallocate the channel, reallocate the resource, reallocate everything for the LPD, and again send the transmission response message. If it is yes, then please continue the data packet received. Okay. So, remember here also the LPD is waiting for the response from the AP for the first packet. So, between the first packet transmission from LPD and the corresponding packet transmission, there is a time gap allotted in the whole transmission process. LPD waited for that packet, for that time duration. Within that time duration, if something is not coming back, any feedback is not coming back, it means actually that first packet is already through. So, I can continue with the same resource allocation from the LPD for this chunk of the data to be transmitted. So, this way this solution is working, and see now what exactly is the data going for the association request message when LPD is first time sending. He is asking what is the data rate requirements for him, what is the quality of service requirements, and what is the processing power of him. So, you cannot tell me a very complicated data processing, AP cannot suggest me a complicated data processing, I cannot do that. Means what kind of sensor network I am, what is my maximum capacity for signal processing, I know. What is the maximum power backup I am having, AP does not know. That is, this is what he is declaring his service capability. I told in the first class that your service capability should be declared in the network, that is very very important. If AP is telling me you just work as a relay, you just relay the network for the delay the data for the next network, whether I am capable to do that, my power backup is there or not, I am just declaring here. So, when I am asking for a request, I am completely telling this is my service requirements. So, this is my data rate requirement. This is my quality of service I want, not only the data rate, what kind of quality of service I want, and what is my processing power. And data rate, to understand that what is your data rate requirement, there is a clear understanding between you and your low power device. So, if it is 000 cent, I am asking for 10 kilobit per second. If it is 001, 125 kilobit per second and go on. These data rates are fixed based on the typical application that the sensor network do. Okay. Quality of service. Quality of service is low, medium, high, or it is kept as an option as reserved if I want some priority also on the quality of the service. Second is the processing power requirement. See, what you can do here is, I told that you have several quality service field value means, actually this is the association request message going on. First 3 bits AP will read that this is coming corresponding to data, the data rate requirement. Corresponding 2 bits he will actually map to the quality of service requirement. Last few bits he will code as a processing power capability of the device. So, when I am saying the QoS field is 001, then AP reads that I have a very low quality of service requirement. Okay. So, you are feeding these fields before sending the transmission request. Okay. Maximum 4 level of quality service is defined by me and what AP also understands. Processing field power, what is this is, see processing field means I am a spectrum based communication system, low power devices. I have multiple channels. What I can do with those channels? If I need enhanced quality of service, I will not ask for the enhanced quality of service to AP. What I will do, you know, I will repeat my data over the multiple frequency bands. As simple as that. And AP can also do the same thing for me when some downlink is coming up. For frequency diversity and all, so what I will do is, I do not need to actually do the put the filters for each and every channel and extract my signal and then do the combination. Here, if I am having a 83.5 megahertz wide channel and if I sample it over 1 megahertz, my ADC is only 1 megahertz wide ADC, maximum 2 megahertz sampling rate, 2 mega samples per second rate, my ADC is sampling. What will happen to my LPD receiver? Remember, it is a low power device, right? I will try to minimize the power at every point of my signal processing. I am sitting in a physical layer. I will never utilize there a filter to filter out my whole 83.5 megahertz first, what Professor Dr. Chakraborty was saying. It is a band filter. Then I will utilize the channel filter. Then the filter cost itself and the power consumption inside the filter is going up. What I will do? I will use the band filter to take the filtration of 83.5. Then I will start using ADC, direct an ADC. I will not filter the channels independently. I will simply utilize a ADC of 2 megahertz samples per second. What I am ending up with? What will happen? Or you just tell the answer if I am using their ADC with sampling at the rate of 1 mega samples per second. What is? Okay, then use 2 mega samples per second. Then what is the final bandwidth of the signal at the output of the ADC? 1 megahertz. And then what exactly is there in that 1 megahertz signal? You remember, you had a 83 megahertz wide signal, just sampled at 2 mega samples per second. Output wise, you are getting a 1 megahertz. Answer is correct. But what is there in that 1 megahertz now? Which signal out of those 83 channels, what are you getting? Fundamental question. Question on the Nyquist rate sampling. I have a bandwidth of 83 megahertz sampled at a rate of 1 mega samples per second. What will happen? Okay, then you do it in 2 mega samples, then I will get a 1 megahertz, right. But shall I get 83 megahertz whole all my channels were there and my whole signal was spread over 83. I have just utilized a 2 mega samples per second ADC. What will happen finally? whole aliasing will happen. You will get the 82 channels folded back on that. Okay, it's very complicated signal now came out of the ADC. How will you separate? That's why LPD has used the spectrum codes. Okay, that's why LPD has used the spectrum codes. I know that all the codes that I have used in each and every 83 channels, all are orthogonal to each other. I need to know just out of all those 83 channels where my data is on 2, on 3 or even on 1 channel or 10 channels. I will actually continuously keep on doing the dispreading based on one by one those codes. Because of the orthogonality nature, all other interferences will go down. I am not bothered about. My signal processing load has come down. My down filtering, mis filtering operation, power consumption due to filtering, power consumption due to frequency synthesizers. Actually, you have to do the frequency synthesization if you wish to shift from one channel to the next channel, and then you select and then put the bandpass filters for the channels. Everything is gone, simply gone. So that's why the circuit, this physical layer solution was very simple for him. Problem. Data rate is definite. That's why it is for sensor networks and low power devices. Devices who are not having a very high data rate, 1 megahertz is a pretty high. So, you can go nicely up to 1 Mbps if BPSK is there, correct? So, if I am, it depends upon what is the length of the spreading code. If I am having length of 8, suppose Hadamard codes and all, so then actually 1 megahertz divided by 8 is the maximum bandwidth I am getting, and I am limited by that. So, I have a choice of the code, right? Then I will do the choice of the codes and vary the length of the codes according to my data rate requirement, as simple as that. Clear? Testing means what? In the simulation platform, yes. In the hardware, no. Simulation platform, it is yes, that it works and nicely works. MATLAB simulation. Problem is what? Problem is that whether you can, so lot of things are possible. You have option to increase your diversity gain by repeating the same signal over multiple frequency bands. They folded, automatically they have added up. How they will be automatically added up? Now tell me. I can get frequency diversity very nicely. I will transmit my same signal over two frequency bands. I will give same code to both of the channels. When I will dispread, automatically by default of your aliasing, they have overlapped. So, when I will utilize the code, so all both the channels who have got the same code, those signals will come out, and by default of signal processing, they are automatically added up. I need not to do anything for frequency diversity in the signal processing in the receiver. So, frequency diversity gain is automatically coming because of the nice architecture already proposed. Another diversity you can get, diversity over the code, that you have to do recently. So, I am utilizing the same channel, but two different codes I have given to a single user. That user is using fast code for a data, and the same data with the same data, but with different code he has spread and utilized transmitted over the same channel. In the receiver, what you need to do, you have to first multiply that channel with the fast code. Whatever you are getting, you take it out. Second code, with second code also try to dispread, you will get also the another data. The data is not different in this case if you are asking for diversity. Data can be different if you are asking for multiplexing. Got it? So, if you are spreading using the same channel, dedicating to different codes, and you are sending the same data over to different codes, you can actually utilize it again for diversity. If you are sending two different data, same channel, two codes, then it is a multiplexing, boosting up the data rate. Now, question is, diversity, same data, two different codes, but two different data, two different codes, channel is same. Because my interference level is such that I am not getting any other channel, but I need to get high data rate. What I will do? I will utilize two different code, but the same channel. If I wish to enhance my quality of service, what I will do? I do not have any option to utilize any other channel. So, what I will do? Same channel, two different code, but same data, spread with the different codes, but the same data, repeat it twice. Now, question is, whenever you are trying to do this code business, two times you have to spread, whether you have the backup power and signal processing power to do that? Means after this spreading, you have to coherently add them up and all and then proceed and feed it to the detector. You may be limited with the power. How do I know? Okay. So, you declare your capacity. See the way of declaration going on. I can do the frequency diversity and code diversity. If I am having the both capability, I have pretty good signal processing power and good power backup also, I will send a value of 0,0. If I am having only frequency diversity capacity, because if I am subsampling, definitely that will happen. I need not to do anything else. That is the bare minimum capability of the system architecture. So, I will send 0,1. If I can do only CD, I cannot do this subsampling stuff and all, I have a fixed FD, I have a high sampling rate, say ADC in me. So, I can only do the CD, I am always dedicated, I can only take care of actually filtering out any one channel. So, I cannot have a variable two different stages, and I cannot process, I am not supposed to do the subsampling related all the issues. If all that is there, then I will talk about only CD. You give me one channel and you give me actually multiple codes, and then I wish to do actually. Maybe I am having the capacity, but I am not ready to do it. I wish need to have that flexibility. So, for this time being, I am only ready to give with CD. So, you can say I am having a corresponding data field of 1,0. Both FD and CD, that is 1,1. If you are not ready to do, have heavy diversity capacity along the code axis or the frequency axis, that also you can declare. So, this declaration is again your service capability and processing power capability you are declaring in the network. And after the admissible data rate and all, there is when the association response message is coming from the AP, he is telling you what is your admissible data rate. Again, he is actually, suppose you have asked for 500 kbps, when you send the data up, you gave the field value 010. AP thought it is not good situation. So, he will tell you, you send with 001. So, you should check first what is coming as an admissible data rate from AP. It is based on the interference profile that AP can see much better than you. So, he may suggest you even the higher data rate, then your time of acquisition of the channel will be very less. So, that is a dynamic setting that AP will finally decide at what data rate you should transmit at this moment. Okay. So, check that field. Then the channel information is coming about, this is a very nice thing, start channel number, number of the channels given to you and channel offsets. Meaning is what? This whole 83 channel that you are having, he knows the interference profile. He will tell you what is the channel number now dedicated, start channel number given to you. It may be number 7, may be number 20, may be number 40, may be number 70. That is the start channel number for you, for your transmission. Second, he will tell how many number of the channels I could give you. So, starting from the channel number 70, you got 3 channel, 4 channel, 2 channel, 5 channel, or 1 number of channels. That number is coming. Last option is, what is the offset? Means, if I can give you contiguous channels, I will feed the offset values as 0. So, that means, start with the channel number 70, say, and I have given you 5 channels with offset value 0, means the channel given to you is 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, done. If I cannot give you contiguous channels, I will tell like this, start channel number 7, I have given you say 5 channels. Offset values are then 2, then 3, then 1, say then 0. So, you start like this, 7, channel number 70, offset 2, leave 71, 72, you acquire 73, and then again you give a offset of 3, go 70, leave 73, sorry 74, 75, 76, acquire 70, again offset value is 1, so leave 1, acquire 78, and then 0 means whatever the channel is left, you contiguously acquire that. So, first I have acquired 70, then 73, then 76, I left 2. So, I will continuously do 78, 79, I am done. To transmit the number of bits you need to transmit. So, 73 you change it in the octet or in the number of the bits required to represent 73. Here I am always restricted with the 1 bit number. Okay. First one is required is 2 bits. For other offsets and identifying the number of the channels I am going to give you, everybody actually requires. So, total number of the bit transmission is also required to be less according to the transmission process. To target that, we did it. So, access point task for the control signal transmission. Control signal transmission means, this is a way actually when the data communication will go on, but when the data, this control signal means how to do the transmission, establish the link, how actually AP will let you know. And these are the very important transmission that cannot be actually considered to be lost somehow, because if this is lost, data transmission can never start. So, I told, so access point identified a group of the contiguous interference free or very low interference free channels for LPD. That is very well done, because initially he did that business, good channel, medium channel and the worst channel or bad channel. So, what he did after identifying the contiguous interference free channels from the remaining channels and all, he generates some primary control signal and he spreads that primary control signal using some fast spreading code, and he transmits also the spread primary control signal to LPD. What LPD does? LPD basically scans over whole 83.5 megahertz band when he has not joined the network, but he intends to join the network. And he determines whether any channel with very low transmit power he can detect or no. Very low power contemporary with his power actually. If he can detect, he tries to dispread it with the primary control signal. Remember, this primary control signal is a very unique control signal and its corresponding code is well known to whole community. So, whenever you are detecting some very primary, very low power some signal over some channel, try to dispread it with your known control signal. If it is, you are getting something out, yes, this is the control signal sent through the beacon from the AP. You read what exactly AP has told you. And he then, once he is getting it, he is sending a response to the access point. Through which channel? Through the channel that he has sensed more or less low interference 1 from his sense of sensing the power from the channel. So, he sent it and then access point will generate the main control signal. Understanding that the low power device could identify my preliminary beacon signal. He has identified somebody is there in the network who is searching for my acquisition, and he could nicely read the primary channel. So, primary control signal. So, he has given me a response. Now, I will actually send him the control signal. Otherwise, I will not send also the control signal. Why? Because it involves the power transmission. It involves the power. So, this whole idea of this whole coexistence issue is, it is power constraint. Nobody is going to transmit anything if it is really not required. Once getting the agreement from the low power device, he will now spread the main control signal with some second spreading code, and he will do that. And now actually, when this fast control signal came, no, what actually is given by AP, you know, he just given a number, please listen me on channel number this. If you dispread the secondary control signal, you will get a number, just a number where to listen. So, immediately the low power device will switch to the channel number that, where it is expected that within few minutes AP is going to send him some very important control signal. Got it? So you also know in the secondary that channel, the main control signal is expected to come in a spread spectrum manner, and you know what actually is the code to spread it. That you know. You didn't know what is the channel number, and that channel number will be dynamically selected by AP seeing the situation of the interference profile. It is not fixed. Like Wi-Fi and all, if it is N, 11N, always Wi-Fi sends the control signal in 2.4 gigahertz, and main data means it will go on the 5 gigahertz. That is well established. But for this, extreme flexibility is that I am not dedicating any channel for the control transmission. Based on the interference profile, I will inform my user, low power user, where am I going to send you the main control signal. Okay. It is done. So, it is the way the channel numbers, start channel number, number of the channels, offset 1, offset 2, I am sending for the control signal, that was the C. This is the whole concept of the way the transformation of the by hardware actually, how if you wish to develop this, implement this idea in the hardware, what are the components you need and how the buses required to be connected to have it, to realize this whole stuff. Receiver actually I already told you are doing the subsampling. This is a transmitter section where actually signal spread, then up converted, added up over all the channels you are transmitting. Receiver section is opposite. You have received the signal and then you have tried to do the RF from the RF unit. You have done the bandpass filtering, then ADC is the subsampling the stuff, and in the baseband processor basically you are dispreading and trying to decode. That is the structure of the normal transceiver receiver. But the protocol is, this is the whole protocol the way they will follow to coexist with the high power device. So, what we understood is the coexistence is a very, very fundamental part, and yes, this last solution is my patent already filed for the USA, and it was really very, very relevant for the kind of the solution, keeping in the mind that the flexibility, expandability, everything is coming up for the short range communication networks, and in general for the any kind of the communication networks, wherever this power will be different for two different technologies, and sharing the same frequency and the same bandwidth if you are trying to find some solution. So, you can, it can be extended for that. Any query? Same type access point means what? Question is actually whether the hardware is supporting the subsampling also in the AP or not. Yes. So, that extension is there, and as the APs are not constrained with the power, so the power backup is always there with them. They are mounted somewhere, this fixed. So, you can have a power supply connected, and all the APs are like that only. So, they are adding some extra. So, it is, there is a power hungriness question for AP. So, at least when AP adding a extra hardware that supports the subsampling based receiver architecture there, that is actually you have to add. So, fundamentally AP, that is the addition of the architecture as well as a supporting software who will actually enable this coexistence in the Wi-Fi AP. That is the solution. So, tomorrow's Wi-Fi AP Cisco can actually add this feature kind of. So, that Wi-Fi is now capable of doing the coexistence with any kind of the software device, I mean any kind of the sensor devices that are coming up that will be addressing same kind of issues. Definitely, definitely. Any other query? Okay.